With each of our films at Pixar, it is so important to do three things really well. Tell a compelling story that keeps the audience on the edge of their seat, populate with memorable, appealing characters, and make the world believable. I don't know if you've ever had the experience on road trips or driving, when you pass some town that's barely a few buildings, and people live there. And you just go, it's like hours from anywhere else, and you go, why? What? And that's the feeling you want McQueen to have. It's like,
where am I?
Where are you? Shoot, you're in Radiator Springs.
Radiator Springs is a mythical town we've created on historic Route 66. When cars were traveling across the desert, you know, they would overheat very easily. The founder of the town, Stanley, it was like a steam-powered car, and he was running out of water, and he found this spring. It's cool, refreshing water. It's like nature's own coolant. And so he just set up shop and first started selling radiator caps, because that's what everybody would lose. And so they would fill up with this nature's own coolant, and he would sell them a new radiator cap. And that's what the start of Radiator Springs was. And when we come into the part of the movie where Lightning McQueen is in Radiator Springs, it's broken up into thirds. The first third is there to reinforce Lightning McQueen's opinion of this town.
We start Act Two with a world that has absolutely no color. He looks around and there's nothing alive. Everything is dead. Yet somehow, characters survived in that world and they see beauty in that place. You're really playing with the psychology of lighting and color. As we progress and we have sunrises and sunsets, we start playing with the lighting on the set and start revealing the background hills. We start like minimizing the atmosphere over distance. To a point towards the end, the whole town pretty much opens up and the lighting on the town and on the hills, everything is looking magical.
When we went out on Route 66, I noticed that every town, every establishment, every building, you stood there and looked at it, and without asking one question or getting one answer, they were telling stories. The cracks in the road where grass was growing, the aged paint, a brick wall that had three different signs painted on, the paint's peeled off and you could see all three. All of these things told you that these establishments, this town, this place was once vibrant, was once full of life, but that's been a long time ago.
I've been looking forward to seeing this place.
Yeah, pressed metal ceiling.
Oh, look at this.
Pressed metal ceiling.
Once you have a lot of research, you also are just finding inspiration within yourself, and so you're doing a lot of sketching and drawing or just writing things down, ideas that occur to you. And so there's a period where you kind of let all that gel and come together, and out of that usually comes themes or symbols that you want to use in the story. I felt that as humans tend to see their own forms in nature, that if cars were the beings in this world, that they would see their forms in nature. Ornament Valley grew out of sort of looking at Monument Valley. It really wasn't very hard to suddenly make this leap and look at forms of cars in these cliff forms. One of them is just an old Chevy, basically, that I saw in a ranch in the town I live in. There is a hood ornament for an old Willys vehicle that it was a wing-like structure. Some of these things looked absurd when you think about it, but once you got them in there and put rocks, textures on them, that looks believable.
Come here, little tractor, come here.
If you've ever been out to the desert or been to a small town, there's a real, just a quality of that I think works in Radiator Springs. You just feel it.
This kind of detail, this patina of Route 66, this was extremely difficult to do with computer animation. The computer likes things perfect, perfectly clean, perfectly shaped, perfect. As soon as you put a crack in it, oh my goodness, have grass growing up through it. You make a brick wall and have multiple layers of peeling paint. Peeling paint is hard. All these things are so difficult to do, but you know what? I knew it was necessary to make this town of Radiator Springs be authentic. Make it feel like it's been there a long time. Make it feel like it had a history. I always thought that you know, you could bring these cars to life like no one's ever seen before, with the chrome, with the metal flake paint, with all this stuff, you know, even driving over a curb and a little splashing of the water, some mud kicked up on a rear fender. You know, it's the kind of details we see on the road every day. But now it's alive.
Our cars, they're characters, but they still have to be cars. And these are 3,500 pound automobiles.
We can't ever let the audience forget that. We can't forget that. They're cars, first and foremost. They're made of metal. It's what I always call the integrity of the object. Respect that, celebrate it, because visually you can't believe what these things are going to look like. I mean, you think you know, wait till you see it. Oh my God.
There's not so much an artistic decision like, what should we do here, what should we do there? They're all artistic decisions, but when it comes to something like subtle little detail like tire treads, you kind of have to do the research. It's getting it right design-wise, but it's also getting it right character-wise. Because Luigi has narrow, little, weak, bias-ply tires that are totally ineffective and the size of a medium pizza. They're tiny. By comparison to McQueen, where his tires are at the corners and they are fat and there's a rubber touch on the road and it's fast and tough like a stock car, it would be wrong to have Luigi have that detail incorrect.
Doc, the flag means go.
With stock cars, they're all similar. So we want to break out and make McQueen look a little more dynamic and interesting, yet still fit in there. So we've got old stock cars from the 70s, you know, the Superbird, and 80s, as well as the modern ones, and then McQueen, which we kind of arrive at this shape. We also had in mind those shots of the trailer where the highlights are just rolling across the character. And then we worked a little backwards and in the other cars, tried to get forms similar to McQueen, so he didn't look so alienated from the rest. And in terms of getting these charming characters, we just started drawing them. And then as we went through, we were learning proportion, balance, how they relate to each other. And I always looked up to one guy, Dave Deal, who was one of my heroes. And he's a car illustrator designer, cartoonist, really. And in the process of this, we got to call him up and have him come up here. And I just love the way he draws cars. He drew them as characters, and they had such personality. And they're almost animated. They had great stance and design and angles. And there's a lot of people who could draw the car physically, but he gave it character and power. It's kind of a dream come true working on this project in that way. So in terms of just charming cars, I think it's more just getting the car right and then bringing some warmth to it in terms of eyes and mouth and expression.
Modeling is basically taking the drawings that an art director has done and creating the geometry that later gets animated in the film, actually fleshing it out in 3D on the computer. Articulation is then giving the character controls to move, basically like adding muscles to a character, whether it's moving, you know, facial muscles, lips, eyes, brows, or general AVARs, what we call animated variables that move a character around, roll the wheels, and things like that.
On cars, we have a whole world of characters, not only cars that are around today, but cars that are old, and not only cars that are old now, but cars that are old the way they were then. And we had to have shaders and surfaces that would reflect that time change.
Textures are beyond the color, sort of what lays into that color to create the surface on a character. Scratches, pitting, denting, rusting. To me, the most challenging texture going into this film and coming out of this film is chrome. Chrome is so reflective that it's really not so much the surface itself, but it's what it's reflecting in the world around it. So we knew it going in that we had to make some real technical strides to get that chrome to look real.
if these things rolled in and they were cartoony, silly, plastic things, it would betray the essence of the story. It's all about truth and the honesty of this place.
Hook them up, Mater.
Okie dokie.
Maynard's great fun because it goes back to some of the research trips we took, but not to Detroit, to 66. I remember in one town we pulled around the corner and there were these old rusty trucks. And one in particular, it was Maynard. We found him. And these cars patina in a different way in the Southwest, where it's not an East Coast rust, it's a sunburn, and the sides kind of retain some of their color and the dirt and the wear, and then I was enamored by that. So we did that trip early on, and you see it in the movie. It is there. You just have the sense of place that came from all that early research.
Is that Pixar, it's really important for all our films to work for everybody, you know? And for our movie Cars, it was important to make it work for non-car lovers as well as people who work in the racing industry, who work in Detroit, who restore cars of all types, who live on Route 66. That's why our dedication to the detail, but also our understanding of making a great story with great characters was so important.
You'd hear a lot of people say, What are you working on? I'm working on a movie called Cars. Oh, Cars. Is that gonna work? Well, yeah, of course it'll work. It's animation. You can animate anything.
Character animation is the performance and the emotion and getting the audience to believe that a toy or a bug or a car or a rat or whatever it is has a soul. John did it with Luxo in his first film. He suggested eye direction without eyes, and he suggested a parent and a child just by the way they moved.
I think Cars is the most John movie that Pixar has made. Taking that ubiquitous inanimate object that people, they don't even notice, and you give it an entire epic story and a population, that's completely personified in this movie with Cars.
You have to immerse yourself in the actual physics of the thing you're animating. The first tests we did looked wrong. You know, they looked like cartoons. The weight wouldn't be right. The physics wouldn't be exactly right. They would look kind of light.
Yeah, these cars talk, and yeah, they move and they bend, but they can't look like rubber. You have to have truth materials. It is metal, and it is paint, and you can only bend it so far before chrome would crack or paint would chip off. We want people to look at it and say, that's 5,000 pounds moving around.
You come up with new ways to translate into this new body type, but the basic nuts and bolts of acting don't really change.
So we have characters that obviously have no arms, no legs, no elbows, no knees, and there's a whole kind of gesturing vocabulary that we all of a sudden don't have.
The hard thing about Cars was figuring out how to emote with these characters that were essentially just heads on four wheels. And those heads weigh 3,000 pounds and they're made of steel. How do you animate a whole world of characters without arms and legs and have differences in the way that they act? You try to study each character and the elements of the character that are going to make them unique, and also study what's unique about that model car.
This man is a good man, and
you know, the sheriff, the way that his suspension was really soft and his tire pressure was much lower. So rather than focusing on the fact that they don't have arms and legs, you focus on what they do have.
Ultimately, it was all about their faces, and we had to become even better experts at animating faces.
The expression's not quite right yet. What I'm missing is a sense of determined confidence. Like, he's not like, you know, that, but it's just a little like, I can do this, right?
Animators get the line reading, they get a shot, but usually it's just a camera setup and the character, a rough environment, and they have to gesture by gesture piece together a performance. Every shot's the opportunity to jump into another character's skin.
Punch me in the face.
In a way, I think to really be an actor and to really have range is simply just to be able to give yourself up to whatever
whatever the character's doing. You can't judge the character.
Punch me in the face. Gotta make him a little more desperate.
There's a moment in the film when Luigi gets to meet a Ferrari. And there's these little ticks that watching Tony Shalhoub when he's doing the recordings, he's
Guido. Guido, there is a real Michael Schumacher Ferrari in my store. I must be dreaming. I must be. Punch me, Guido. Punch me in the face.
At first, I was just had him talking. Guido, this is a Ferrari, blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, John came in and being John go, no.
I would amp up maybe through the high frequency little shakes of just the excitement.
And on one sense, it's just this one line and it's this one emotion of, hey, your idol just showed up and you're excited and you want to tell your best bud, but you don't want him to know that. But when you go to execute it, you have to think about all these things like, you know, I don't want to miss a second of this.
This is the most glorious day of my life.
Wow.
It's almost like you're translating all this stuff into your car language of what you have at your disposal.
You ask any animator that worked on the show at the end of the production, they would say that it was fun. It's fun to have that limitation because you end up having to come up with creative solutions.
I have not seen a lot of other racing movies, but the ones I have seen tend to err on the side of incredible and ridiculous.
There's nothing worse for a car person than watching a movie and seeing something totally out of context. You're watching, say, like a period 50s movie and a 70s Volkswagen Beetle goes by. That's the most annoying thing in the world to a car person.
I love cars, I love racing, I love all that. And so I got really geeky with the detail and trying to get it all authentic.
One of the things that has really impressed me in the way John has approached this movie is absolute determination to get it right. And I saw that early on just from the standpoint of audio. We've had sound engineers from Pixar here at our track and visiting other tracks around the country, just recording sound and making sure that they get that piece of it right.
Because they are cars that talk, you want to give them some legitimacy. You want some reality based in this film because, yeah, they do, you know, these are talking cars and they could do anything if you didn't ground them in some sort of reality.
There's a scene when Doc Hudson is doing the sideways slide in the dirt, this beautiful moment where he's really getting back into his dirt racing heritage and he goes into the sideways turn, showing McQueen how you have to turn left to go right. And you see the wheel spinning almost in slow motion and the lug pattern on the wheels is a correct bowl pattern. Come on, how many people are gonna do that?
There's these icons in the racing world and I got to meet them and I got to talk to them. And the more I talked to them, the more I realized I want them in this movie, because you can't reproduce the way they sound.
The Hudson Hornet was my inspiration.
That was the one. You really felt like you meant it. That was great.
You can't reproduce the authenticity that you hear in their voice.
I just hope Lightning's okay. I sure would hate to see anything bad happen to him.
Their understanding of the sport.
So what makes race car drivers better than average drivers is they don't panic. You got to sit on a hot stove and pee ice water. Not a lot of guys can do that. It's hard to do.
Oh, he's got it in the bag. Call in the dogs, put out the fire. We're going to crown us a new champion.
I think one of the things that appeals to people as fans of motor racing is you see guys going fast around a racetrack, and we all drive cars, and we all have that sense that we could mash the pedal and do what they're doing ourselves. And until you get in a car with a professional driver going around a racetrack, it's really difficult to understand how skilled these guys are relative to what the rest of us can do in a car. All of the animators who were working on this movie came and spent a day at the track, and it's an amazing sensation, and I think having them go through that experience and understand some of the dynamics was a pretty key element.
I love this job!
It was kind of scary to think that, you know, these guys are going to drive that fast in this. They were just so casual about it. They weren't even taking it to the full extent.
Not only did we want to make the racing authentic, we wanted to make the way the racing was portrayed on television, the broadcasting of the racing, authentic.
I went running to my office and said, John Lasseter wants to have a meeting with me. And she says, why? I said, they say he wants to talk about racing on TV. Camera one is right at the start-finish line, so he sweeps all the way through, and usually I use camera one all the way through if I'm doing the pointers. Camera three is the exit of pit road.
Season points lead, heading into the final race of the season.
The racing scenes just knocked my socks off. They did exactly what we talked about and what they said they were going to try to do, my little suggestions, and they put it all together, and it was like everything I want to do live for Fox.
It captures racing in a way that you can't even do it in real life. John Lasseter put a dimension to it that I never thought he could pull off.
It doesn't matter what it is. If we do something in our movies, we make sure that it's correct, that it's right, and it's something that'll stand up. And that's something that John was very conscious about as a person who grew up in car culture. He didn't want to use the wrong color.
Doc's color's not accurate. We should get, there is a 1951 stock color that's a darker blue.
And a nutty amount of detail that gets missed, and I would probably say 75% of movies with old cars, there's always something that they get wrong, and I always spot it because I look at that stuff. And as far as I know, we did a pretty good job of covering the bases on this movie.
When I first took a look at a Hudson Hornet, and they said this car was the fastest car of its day, and I looked at it and go, but it looks like a grandpa car. But then you look at this car, you dig deeper, you realize this was an innovative car. It was so powerful and so fast.
This car was a milestone car in the history of NASCAR, no question about it. And the guys that drove them won races big time.
It was the first of the step downs, which the passenger sit down low into the car, low center of gravity, which made the car handle very well.
Back then, a lot of the tracks were dirt, and so it could race through dirt better than anything else.
It is the first unibody car. The frame and the body are all one, and it makes for a much better handling car. It's safer. Everything about it is better.
It had a fabulous inline engine. Didn't have a V8. It was an inline engine with two carburetors in a day when you just didn't do that with a passenger car. You never had to put any water in them once you put them in. They never overheated. And when they raced, they just kept on going, lap after lap after lap.
And they won championships in 51, 52, 53, and they ran very well in 54.
Outside of just its race history, it's an elegant, well-proportioned, handsome car. Even the way they painted those things were great. The fabulous Hudson Hornet. I mean, when it says fabulous, that's a great car already.
But it looks like a grandpa car, and it was perfect. And so out of that came the character of Doc Hudson.
Okay, look, Grandpa, I'm not a bulldozer. I'm a race car.
Oh, is that right? Then why don't we just have a little race, me and you?
And there's that marriage between that beautiful old car and Paul Newman that made HUD. I mean, it's a perfect match.
He's 80 years old and he's still racing, and he's so good at it. That's his passion in life. He's a great actor, but he loves racing.
It isn't just that you go through a turn or two turns or three turns. It's that you go through 50 laps on the outside, on the inside, on the inside, on the outside. You know, every lap, inches never touch.
Ka-chow!
We produced graphics in the order of, you know, thousands.
Wow, I mean, there were so many product stickers just on the race cars alone.
Graphics on the track itself, along the fence, on the broadcaster's booth.
All the team trailers, all the cars, the press passes, camera crews, police cars. What's on a police car? You know, stars on the door. Is it stars?
Medications that a car might use, a product that a car might eat.
Everything has a brand. Everything is adorned with a label.
Icons for the restrooms. The label on a fire extinguisher.
Postcards and bumper stickers and old enamel signs and gas pumps.
This went on and on. You get a little myopic when you're building your graphics because you might just be doing reporters and camera truck. But the shot has 10 reporters, 10 camera trucks, and then all the people watching the interview taking place, and then all the race cars behind it. It's overwhelming at times.
The graphics really add an extra layer of detail that really make the environments or even the characters a lot more realistic or believable.
When you're in stores like that that we went into on Route 66, these souvenir shops, there is so much stuff on the walls. It's like this patchwork quilt of colors and shapes and forms. Everywhere you look, there's something, there's many things in front of you.
There were so many different aspects to the film that we were asked to come up with ideas for. There were store names in Radiator Springs. There was Miss Piston and Wimpy's Wipers. And what would those stores carry? For example, at Flo's Diner, what would she advertise? What would these cars eat? Hot buttered lug nuts, hot brake pads, frosty antifreeze. You know, things like that that were kind of diner-ish, but something that cars could relate to.
We wanted to create brands that reflect our world and give people in the audience something to relate to.
That ended up being really fun because you'd have to come up with a whole graphic package for a non-existing product. Like, how would it look on the shelf? What would the packaging be for it? And then how would they paint a car for this non-existent product?
Invent your own logo, invent your own brand.
One person would come up with a name, then somebody else might design the graphic for it.
We took hits at it and then handed them back and forth.
Design 20 or 30 different versions of that.
Put them together, we'd show them to John, you know, and he would kind of pick out what he likes, or maybe he would come up with some of his own ideas.
You know, like a sports drink. What's the car culture equivalent of a sports drink? Perhaps they're using nitro or a gas additive or a... Then we filter that into our fantasy world, and voila, Nitro-Aid.
There's so much detail and attention to detail and gags, and just they're everywhere.
It's not the central story, but it's kind of this million stories in the background. You know, every little thing has a backstory to it.